And I want to ask you a question now, because I don't think it's one of the key questions, but I think it's an interesting one, which is, why do you think some of these have got medals and some haven't? All the ones with medals have got some things in common, but it's definitely not that they're the good ones.
No, it's strange, isn't it?
Conspicuously not.
Some of them are really bad.
Absolutely dreadful that have medals.
Yeah, this one, Felix Cabarrocas of Havana, Cuba, number 1883. It's got these three funny little towers on top. It's got this rather darling sort of loggia act, 20th story level.
Most of the ones we described before, by the way, got honourable mentions, including the, you know, giant German and the weird...
I think some of it is politics. I think some of it is that, although they claim that everything is anonymous, I think it's fairly clear that they made sure that they gave honourable mentions to the people who they tapped up to enter and to remain on good terms. I think also that if you read the report of the jury, what they say is that their concerns were primarily pragmatic, that they were looking for someone who really understood the programme of the office building. And the problem is, for most of these, all we're looking at is the view. So we just have the image. We don't have any sense of the plan, which might give us some more clues as to what's being marked there. I think it's also quite possible that the jury is just... that they just let all these like strange, slightly crazed military officers choose whichever one
they like
best.
That's what I was going to say. Could it be that on a competition they've chosen a completely inappropriate bunch of people to judge it, and they've chosen all sorts, and they've made all sorts of mad decisions based on, oh, my granny went to Dusseldorf and they've got an interesting, and so on and so on. One thing they like is they like the bottom to have 16 stories of rectangle extruded up. That's in common. Like, nearly all of the successful entries have the same middle bit with slightly different window dressing.
But the ones which do better are, you know, ones like the winner, where they've selectively made a bit of it higher and kind of elided or pushed into the background all of the rest of the programme to accentuate the toweriness.
Or just taken, say, half or two-thirds of it and extruded all that up, and then at about the 15th floor tapered it in a few times. There's a lot of them. And no modernist one.
No, the modernists didn't get anywhere.
Nothing avant-garde or modernist was acceptable.
I think we should talk about the modern... There are various groups of people from outside of the academist style who enter. There are a group of modernists in the Walter Gropius style who are doing these quite stripped back, very sort of rectilinear, like cuboidal things. There is a group of broadly expressionists allied with Bruno Taut, who himself entered, and there's a Dutch group, but there is also a group, there's a quite well-known entry by Adolf Loos, which is one of a series which adopt this very, very, very strange approach. Loos's entry takes the form of a vast black Doric column with a great big base. The middle part is this sort of circular column, and then at the top there's this big projecting cantilever, which is the capital of the column. And
which is the thing I knew about this competition when I was 17.
Was this entry?
Was I knew Loos's giant columnetry. And I don't know if that's general, but I think that it's definitely much more famous than the building that was built. Or any of the other entries. And the funny thing is that several other people did giant columns as well.
Yeah. That's one of the strange discoveries. Is there were loads. So number 160, there's a guy called Paul Gerhardt who did one. Or he actually did multiple entries. Yeah, so there's Loos is number 196. And I think that his is probably the more convincing of them, because he uses the sort of semi-fluting of the column to post-rationalize this vertical piers they tend to have between the windows, so they become the kind of outer part of the flute. There is, Gerhardt's one is, he has two next to each other. His one is a sort of Egyptian column, which even has a kind of shining crystal on the top. But he also has one which is an enormous obelisk, which is displayed right next to it. They're basically the same. In one sense, the column does sort of make sense as a form for this, because it's got this tripartite structure. You've got a base, you've got a body of a column, you've got a top bit. The skyscraper design, that was very much how they worked. You had three vertical zones whose difference was quite clearly expressed, a base, a shaft, and a crest. What are the other really strange ones that they've tried? The huge obelisk, the Egyptian column. There's one guy who does the whole thing as an enormous arch, which is one of almost one of the last ones.
The pyramid, which is a very elongated Roman pyramid.
Oh, yeah, with sort of multiple kind of porticos.
Which I think would really struggle to work, but would be very striking.
It would look amazing, yeah. There's this one, the Salvatore, Saverio Dioguardi from Bari in Italy did one which is an enormous arch with a huge ball on top, which has almost no rentable area at all. And it has like a bronze, it's like a huge arch, the sides of the arch are sort of offices, and then driving through the middle of the arch is the like bronze chariot, which is like three stories tall. And then on top of the arch is another sort of structure, and then on top of that is like it would be gold, wouldn't it? It'd be like an enormous
hang on hall. He got a prize.
no, that's the one next to him.
Oh my god, the one next to it is so much worse.
Yeah, it's rubbish.
This is great. I mean, it's totally ridiculous. If you're used to designing camp Italian, the Italian architecture of this period is not good.
No, we're not. I mean, actually, we are. There is an interesting avant-garde, but it's very much not what most people are doing.
Yes, but what they're actually building, they're still in the very bad period of Italian architecture. This is the most wedding cakey of wedding cakes.
Yeah, it's very, very bizarre. Yeah, I love the huge gold ball surrounded by, it's kind of supported by all these sort of slaves, isn't it?
Yeah, there's lots of big bronze sculptures everywhere and huge sort of stone arches. And yes, no office space.
Yeah.
It's just a massive monument.
There's one, 252, which is another Italian one. I mean, we shouldn't talk too much about them because they're so like weird, which is this kind of Neapolitan Baroque or something.
There are varying styles of draftsmanship. This one is like Piranesi.
It looks like you got the perspective wrong because it's gone right off the top of the piece of paper. I think you made a mess of it.
Also, the people in it. He's almost the only person who's drawn any people in it.
Yeah, they're huge.
And they're giants. 4 meters tall. It's reverse Piranesi.
Yeah, he's made a bit of a mess of it.
Should we talk about the drawing style a bit? Because there's a variety of drawing styles. They specified the angle of the perspective of these, which people adhere to with varying degrees of success. It had to be in black and white.
You were allowed sepia and these kind of things. It's just colour, you weren't allowed. They're rendered, in the original sense of the word, by hand, with inks and pencils and all these sorts of things. And many of them are pretty amazing. I mean, this was an era when people were extremely good at doing this.
I almost can't talk about it because I keep looking up and down at all these insane things that people have proposed. Look at this guy. It's like loads of spirals. And this one is very, very odd indeed. It's like a generic office building with something on top that I'm not sure I can even describe. Number 200. It's like, it's not a very good one.
What is that?
Yeah, wow. Describe that thing on top.
It's like
it's a bridge.
It looks like a sort of early medieval cathedral wall, and on one side, and then the same on the other side, presumably. And in between, there's like a big arch, which looks like kind of Roman bridge from from the south of France or something. I don't know.
All of this with no windows or anything.
No windows at all. It has a feeling of this kind of spiritually infused kind of medieval vibe, you know. We could talk about the expressionist entries.
Yeah, I'm on one now. 221. Which is a bit like the roof of your favoured Finnish entry, except the whole building is castle evil. But I suspect it might also be the Crystal Palace.
I think very much so.
If it was coloured glass, it would be a Bruno Taut building, but with Gothic styling, and that's not, I think, completely coincidental.
Yeah, it's got a slight feeling of expressionist buildings of the period, like the Hiele House from Hamburg, these brick expressionist with a kind of, there are these medieval references, there are these slightly sort of faceted forms, and there's this strong crystalline abstract Gothic verticality in the way that it's put together. Should we talk about the actual Taut entry? It's another strange one.
Well, it's worth saying there are two Taut entries, because there's one from Bruno and one from Max.
Oh, yeah. So Bruno very much fits into the expressionist camp.
Although, a very different take on the expressionists. So the ones we've had are kind of finialed glass palaces.
Yeah, or
with
kind of
with
brick,
spiky
yeah.
roof lines, or brick ones, but they've got complicated roof lines and crosses and diamonds. The Bruno Taut one looks pretty plausible. Starts as a square modernist tower with strong corners, and then it tapers to a point from a square.
So it's like a single... in section, it has this slightly sort of Gothic curve and point.
It's very much more modernist. It's not quite plausible as a building from the 1980s, but it almost is. It looks vastly more plausible than most of these buildings. I mean, it's paired with the one on the same page next to it is another German entry, which is a giant North American Indian with a tomahawk.
Yeah, like
that's
a
what
Herm,
the building is.
A Herm. Heinrich Mostorf, Hans Hahn, Bruno Busch. Yeah, who I think were having fun with this one.
Yeah, no, I think not entirely serious. It's worth saying there are a lot of German entries because the German economy right after the war wasn't great.
Yeah.
But there were lots of architects from the glory days from before the war. So all these unemployed architects put stuff in. And I think almost none of them got any commendation at all.
We could talk about the other Taut, who very
yeah,
much
marked... Yeah, it's very easy to talk about the Max Taut. He's done what is completely plausible office building from any period, from then to now.
Yeah.
And it is a grid office block of a few different heights, a few different sort of blocks, with large plate glass windows. It looks very plausible. It's quite nice.
Yeah, it sort of steps back a little bit. The tallest bit is in the middle of the plan.
But it looks like an office building.
And he's one of several. There's a Walter Gropius entry, which differs only really in having some sort of expressed balconies, I think.
Which feel a bit like sort of Atomic Age. Or there's some very ugly buildings like that are being built in London right now, which have slightly poisoned the idea to me. The idea of curving balcony going up and down the facade.
Yeah. One of the things, so there's an essay about this by Manfredo Tafuri, and one of the things he talks about in the context of the German entries is that there's this sort of peculiar contradiction in the Bruno Taut tendency, which is that they want to do the skyscraper the most urban of buildings in a fundamentally anti-urban ideology.
Well, it's because he wants it to be the Stadtkern, doesn't he?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He wants it to be the empty oblong building in the middle of his organised city to which everyone looks up in awe and aspires, but in the middle of Chicago, surrounded by other ones.
Yeah, but the mode of representation actually suits it, because they're all drawn as if they are the only building in the universe. So it does kind of allow them to bridge this this contradiction.
Do you find his entry that inspiring?
No, it's not very good, this one.
I find it's very believable, I think. It's extremely... It feels quite pedestrian.
Yeah, I like 228, which is another expressionist one, Gerhardt Schröder, which is...
It's got a kind of concertinaed facade with a crenellated roof.
Yeah.
It's very heavy and dark.
Yeah, rendered in very sort of sharp relief.
Looks a bit like, you know those like wooden hammers you have for hammering steak with zigzaggy tops?
A meat hammer.
Meat hammer.
It looks like a meat hammer. Yeah, it's good.
I like the Fritz Sackermann, which has almost nothing rendered on it at all, except these lines that go up and then curve and then come down again. Which is...
That one is very bizarre.
And it has a person. It's a bit like a sort of... It's kind of like the entry from De Chirico.
Yeah, what does it look like? I mean, I don't know where that comes from. It has a tiny bit of Hans Pilzig's Neue Schauspielhaus with those kind of very blank, droopy... little mini arches, but essentially it appears you can't, I assume those are windows, but they have no
there's no detailing. It's just a few vertical lines.
Yeah, it looks like it could just have no windows at all,
and it feels, apart from the figure, who is completely the wrong size, I think, or perhaps isn't, perhaps it's completely the right size, it feels the wrong scale.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the personal favourite, which is one of the ones right at the end, completely anonymous. Actually, the last entry, number 281, which is looks like the lantern of St. Peter's on top, but sort of amputated and completely hollow. And it's on these four sort of piers, but you can see through the gaps in between the piers into the inside.
Into the light well. A lot of these towers did have light wells down the middle of them.
Yeah.
And the bottom is like Venice, like the Mars.
And then on top of it, it's got this amazing Art Nouveau sculpture that looks like something from a Hector Guimard or something. It's amazing, actually. I mean, if someone was to build this, it would be just the best thing ever.
It's camper's Christmas.
It is so mad. Oh, there's that nice bit, yeah, light wells. This is completely tangential, but there's a nice bit, Franz Kafka's America, where he knows that there are light wells and he knows that there are lift shafts, but he assumes that they're the same thing. So you kind of, the lift goes up and down. It's this big thing which goes up and down inside the light well.
But that actually isn't completely wrong, because that's how a lot of the early lifts were shown off and were. So you'd have the light well in the middle, and then you'd have lifts going up and down in the middle of it.
Just hanging free.
Not hanging free, but bolted onto the wall.
Yeah. Oh, right.
Going
well,
up and
so
down
it's
the middle.
He may have been right.
There's a lovely early lift technology, which is where you have the thing bolted to the exterior wall, and then next to it there's a pipe with a water bucket in it, and you pull a lever, you have a brake handle, and you pull a lever, and the water bucket fills up until you think that the counterbalance is heavier than the lift, and then you let go of the brake, and you go flying up the building or flying down the building. And then you just stick this brake into the wall, and then you hopefully stop at about the right place. And it was favoured because it was very fast. They all needed quite skilled operators. They also usually had large plush sofas in them.
Yeah, which is good. Yeah, we should do something like these.
There's lots of interesting ways they did lifts, and I don't think Kafka is particularly wrong, actually.
No,
right. And a lot of the early lifts were bonkers. They hadn't worked out
what it was going to be.
How it was going to work, yeah. That it wasn't just going to be this bucket of water.
Interesting.
We've got a lot of our mates from the Crystal Chain.
Yeah, they've all put something in. Not particularly favoured.
There's Scharoun. There's Wassili Luckhardt. That's Wassili. Both of them did anonymous entries.
Yeah.
Which I think means that they were so irrelevant that the people couldn't even be bothered to record their names. By Jove, throw up their shoulders to that raggedy melody full of originality, Italian opera singer.
Should we talk about reception?
Yeah, okay, so we sort of said that people are doing all these different things, and some people won.
Yeah.
And immediately there was a big strain of thinking that the second prize should have won. That was, I think, a big part of the immediate reception.
So, to start with the immediate reception, it's a huge success. It produces, as desired, a huge amount of publicity.
Yeah.
A travelling exhibition of a set of the entries, the ones, the kind of most favoured ones, goes travelling the country, attracting, you know, lots and lots of visitors. It makes 27 different stops. And they also do a huge exhibition of it in Chicago, where they take over the entire top floor of the Art Institute, which is the big Chicago museum. It, all in all, that really works out for them. As you say, there's controversy, which is that there is a feeling that, in fact, the Saarinen entry, which was placed second, is better. The Hood and Mead Howell's entry.
But he sort of has the last laugh, because it seems to get built about six times in various places all over America in the 20s, 30s and 40s.
Yeah.
Why do you think they thought it was better?
Oh, let's have a look at them.
I have a few theories. Well, I have a few reasons why I think it's better. So, I think the first thing is that the decorative elements are integrated into the building, so that it is building all the way up and doesn't rely on this massive camp top to make it into something.
Yeah, these huge, the huge flying buttresses.
The architecture is the thing. The flying buttresses on the other one don't do anything. They're just decoration.
Yeah.
Whereas this, he successfully manages to use the facade and the stepping in to provide, probably more successfully, a lot of the same stuff, with a greater economy, if not of material, then of sort of language. And he has, in a sense, managed to enfold the duty of creating as much tallness, as much slenderness and upwards energy without relying on slapping loads of material on the top to do it, by having this stepping in and having this gradation of detail.
It's much finer, isn't it? It's become much more of an integrated surface of the facade. There is still a certain kind of crudeness. The different elements of the Hood and Mead Howell scheme are not totally resolved with one another. The windows feel a little bit industrial, and they feel like they're less convincingly meshed in with the big expressed masonry verticals.
And especially if you look at the section, it very much is a totally generic skyscraper with some Gothic detailing around the base and a massive thing slapped on top, which has no floor space in it at all. Everything from where those flying buttresses begins is a hollow room. There's three spaces. There's a hollow room, there's a water tank, and there's a viewing deck. Yeah. And that is the top quarter.
Yeah.
No, third. The top third of the tower is just that. So it hasn't really enmeshed the Gothic or the Gothic language in a way that the finished proposal has succeeded. Serenin has the same language throughout. The Gothic is turned down and it is more consistent. And the whole thing is a tower.
Yeah.
Whereas the other one relies on a lot of top doing nothing.
I tend to agree.
But I still think they should have done some of the more interesting ones. I think a lot of them are really clunky. I think the clunky historicism looks really funny. It's really interesting to look at, but it's stupid as hell. And I think that about the Beaux-Arts. I like it because it's exotic to us. Because it's a way of thinking which is so different to the way that we think now in architecture. And it's so transgressive. It's like all the felt-tip pens of Jean Renaudy. You can't go in with a felt-tip pen school. You just couldn't try and pull off this stunt. People would think you were mad. Yeah. I mean, actually, there were folk in the Bartlett in the 80s doing this. There was a revival because of postmodernism.
So I think we should come on to that in a bit, because this one of the ways that this has an afterlife is in postmodernism. And I think, yeah, one of the puzzles for me is I find this a lot more likable than postmodern.
Yeah, because it's not ironized, isn't it?
Yeah.
This isn't ironized, but it is sort of...
sort of bad.
It's sort of bad. I would really like if they'd made a few of them.
Yeah. Oh, it'd be a fun city, wouldn't it? I mean, I think this is... you could pitch this as a computer game environment or something.
I thought you were going to say we should just build them all in China.
Yeah, that would be great.
Just a whole city of them.
In a Mongolia or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, every single one. So, in terms of the way in which people have interpreted the significance of this project, I think there's two big ways in which people have interpreted its significance. One is in the context of the history of the architecture of the capitalist city. So the relationship between the skyscraper and the emerging modern capitalist city. So between the Chicago Tribune competition and production, as it were. So there's this history, which we already alluded to, by Manfredo Tafuri, where he talks about, in a way that which I think we've also covered a bit of, some of these inherent contradictions within the project of the skyscraper, between the skyscraper as pragmatic structure and the skyscraper as the architectural style. Pragmatic structure of it wants to be regular, wants to be sort of system built, and also, critically, is really the same sort of thing as all of its neighbours. It's like we're in a city of generic floor plates placed on top of generic floor plates, which together in a composite way are a sort of image of the big piles of money which are going into them.
There is an interesting property of their function, which is that the floor plates in Chicago are for offices managing the speculation of materials, and their finance. And finance is about projecting an image and confidence. So key to their function, that they project an image. The image is very important, that they really are decorated sheds.
Yeah, a term, in fact, I think invented by the critics of the Columbian Exposition. What was I going to say? Oh, right, yeah. So then there's this tension between the architecture of the skyscraper as the stacking of the floor plates and of each building trying to be its own sort of autonomous, independent, identifiable architectural expression. That each one wants to be this sort of singular creative act, but its nature is to be part of this generic landscape of productive space.
But looking in the competition, you can see actually there are points where it is resolved. Yeah. It's a tension, but not an irreconcilable tension. And in fact, the second entry is quite good at it, because the building is iconic and yet speaks more readily to just being part of a continuous system, yeah, a system of the city, than the ones which are more consciously I am architecture icon buildings.
Yeah, and which in their representation have this kind of pretense towards being the only building in the universe, as it were. You know, they're kind of floating there.
The way that, a lot of them express this dichotomy is that they have the productive building as a totally standard productive building, and then they literally separate off the function of iconography.
The spire.
Put it on the top, yeah, and the bottom.
Yeah.
Which is very literal, but not, it doesn't work. The current solution to this is to make the building a funny shape.
Yeah, you make them sort of funny branded shape. Well, there are two responses. One is a kind of lame branded shapey making, like your cheese graters, your walkie talkies. Then the other one is sort of facadism. So it's the one with the fritted pink glass and Portland stone with laser cut pattern in brass building, behind which is the same generic floor plate. You know, in the contemporary moment, that's sort of what they're, how it all works.
But even buildings that step alongside outside, you know, even the CCTV building, which is an interesting building, the solution is to make it a groovy shape, which isn't really about anything else.
Yeah. I want to come back to this via something else, because I think that it's an interest, it's important. So both Tafuri and then also Pier Vittorio Aureli in a later essay, but which I think is kind of channeling a lot of the same stuff.
Yeah, I'm reading both of them. I thought that Tafuri was clearer.
Yeah,
in
thinking. I've got a bit of a crush on Tafuri. I think we might have to. We'll do an episode at some point.
I think he's. Yeah.
Have you ever looked at a photo of him?
No.
Look it up.
Okay.
He looks like how I imagine the kind of podcasting ideal.
Okay, this is what we're aspiring to.
He's
okay.
Got like an enormous beard and a huge cigar, and he looks completely like. He looks like he's always been on the sesh, basically. I think that both of them talk about this quote-unquote entry, which in fact was never entered for the competition at all by the German architect Ludwig Hilbesheimer, which is a version of the Chicago Tribune where the entire building is reduced to this ghostly grey cuboid with these entirely regular rectangular windows, and it's become almost a diagram of a building. All of the communicative elements of the building have disappeared completely, and we're left almost with this sort of washed out building without qualities version of it. The significance of this project is read in different ways. In Tafuri, he talks about it as being the logical conclusion of something which is going on in some of the modernist entries to the competition, which is the annulling of the communicative aspect of the architectural design, that what they're moving towards is an architecture which is pure expression of kind of economic forces or the kind of the economic machinery of the city, and really fits into these. You know, Hilbesheimer also has this famous project for a city which is kind of looks like a sort of extruded microchip of these grey featureless blocks with enormous networks of cars and infrastructure running in between them.
Yeah, there's a couple of ways I read that one. And the first one is, I think it has a relationship with the much more famous American zoning diagram. You know, the one which is in New York, the maximum buildable area.
Yeah, this is a
these famous drawings by Hugh Ferris of the, which draw the zoning envelopes.
The zoning, yeah, and then
solid.
Through an iterative process, convert them into buildings,
yeah.
Which is the almost parametric extrapolation of the zoning diagram into the American building. One of the key properties of the American skyscraper was its stepping quality,
yeah.
Which is a response to various things, but one of which is the zoning of light, which is these very crude urban controls. And Hilbersheimer has most definitely not stripped away the communicative elements of building. In fact, that building is almost entirely an act of communication.
In what sense would you say?
In the sense that he has drawn on a piece of paper an image of extrapolation of the criteria. Not necessarily of the brief, but the criteria of an office block. It is separated so that, you know, it's two separated towers so that they can get light. Then it is an expression of the structure and an expression of windows without anything there, which is an almost aggressive act of communication.
Can I give you a little quote here?
Yeah.
So he's talking about the three projects, Max Taut's, Walter Gropius's, and Ludwig Hilbersheimer's. The historical significance of the three projects here is paradigmatic. From Gropius's design to Hilbersheimer's, they offer a synchronous demonstration of the entire course of the avant-garde movements. From Gropius's attempt to endow the pure articulation of signs with semantic value, through the mediation of Max Taut's project, this line of development ultimately produces a hallucinatory emptiness.
The Hilbersheimer is very empty. The Max Taut one is like a Hilbersheimer where it's just been made into more of a building. Gropius is, he's taken the building and added a fin to it, basically, a running fin as a balcony, which follows paths along the grid.
It's one of those classic, almost deco-y lifts from the design of sports cars or ocean liners or whatever. This kind of communication of technological speed and velocity.
But the communication technology is all there in Hilbersheimer. These huge sheet plate glass, this utterly flush facade, which has more in common with the kind of clunking door of a Mercedes. The expression of mass production. We talked a lot with Michelangelo about creating the strength you have in the completely horizontal lintel line and this grid of squares, which expresses the high tech of it almost ignoring physics. Overcoming physics completely with machine technology, and the notion that the organic or the chemical origin or the productive origin or engineering is utterly overcome by an expressed notion of optimization in some sort of thing. This thing is an expression of its function, but it is not its function, it is an expression of it. It is a diagram. The optimal office building as construed by Hilbersheimer, rather as he construes the optimal city. But they are rhetorical optimums. And in fact, its very nature as a rhetorical proposal suggests that it is nothing but communication. There is actually no building, it is just semiotics.
What was I going to say? Oh, well, in the context of the Aureli essay, there's something added which is a relationship between that Hilbersheimer project and the kind of the new nature of work. So that we're in these buildings, we're producing these identical floor plates for this thing called the office job. And the office job can be that you're a journalist, or the office job can be that you work in HR of some kind, or whatever they called it at that point, or that you're in insurance, or that you're trading in one kind of commodity or another. But you're in any
Or most likely you are writing the addresses on envelopes, cranking calculating machines, being a messenger inside an office building, being a lift operator.
But that all of these, that there is suddenly there's a kind of a sort of flexible interchangeability that's going on, that there's a kind of undifferentiated quality to the environments of work, and that the facades of the Hilbersheimer building are expressing this. He calls it a kind of even covering of the field, that this is sort of open plan
as expressed in the design of the facade.
An expression of the factory system, as applies to... So, like, something I found interesting, which I discovered when I was reading economic history, is that the factory emerged before there is any reason for it to emerge in terms of technology. It emerges first as a technology of control. So it allows you to watch all your workers who are doing their piecework. And subsequent to that, although pretty soon after that, you get capital-intensive technologies which require everybody to be in a particular sort of building. So it might be a cotton factory. But later on, it might be a telephone exchange, which requires people to sit in rows in a big machine and plug things together in a white-collar setting. But once you're a typewriter operator rather than a telephone exchange operator, you can be anywhere and in any space. And so the space you need is a panopticon space combined one with one which has got... So the purpose of you being in that particular point is that you are near key point of communication, physical and you know, informational, and that you are able to be watched by your employer. That still exists, you know, that's the call centre. But I think it misses the reason why they have such a focus on glorifying these buildings, which is the nature of the fact they have to project an image, which is immensely important in the skyscraper, which is a speculative...
Yeah, because you're trying to, you have to attract the people who are actually going to inhabit
it. And the people have to go into that sort of thing because image is immensely important in business, which is on based on confidence, knowledge, and trust.
So, should we talk about?
And I think O'Reilly, I think he slightly misses
why these things can't be generic, or
why they can't be generic. Why so much effort goes into not into disguising, obfuscating, and has always and will always.
To disguising the generic. Sort of interchangeability of it. What is it? There's the quote from Junk Space. The you know, we're sort of slaves to the arbitrary or whatever it is. What is it?
Because we it's like having given up on the specific. We make ourselves slaves to the arbitrary. Yeah. But it's sort of, you know.
Anyway, listen to that episode. The other big critical appropriation of this project is in the context of postmodern historicism and in this emerging interest in these as projects which are communicative, which adopt and appropriate...
Unlike every other human artifact.
But you know that they consciously use style to send certain messages, and that they also sort of hybridise and play games with this sort of repertoire of different elements. In his introduction to the American edition to the Architecture of the City, Aldo Rossi talks about his love of the American city. One of the things he's trying to do is to contradict anyone who says, which I think would be a reasonable reading, well, all the things which you're describing in the context of these Italian cities, surely these things don't exist in the cities of the New World.
And he offers two defences. Yeah. One is a photograph of Nantucket, which is not exactly... Nantucket, yeah. And the other one is saying that the only entrant to this that truly understood the American city was Loos.
Yeah.
Which is completely wrong as well.
Well, so he sees these skyscrapers as these sort of signs in conversation with one another. And I think that there's something attractive to him about it because at that great scale where we're seeing the true protagonists of the city is as these enormous skyscrapers, actually all the people have sort of disappeared and it's become one of these little hermetic symbolic kind of theatrical games that he
And onward to Rem Koolhaas and Delirious New York and
they're all jumping into bed with each other,
which makes sense. But actually I think if he had known, I mean, I don't know very much about the American city either, but I think there is a story of the interrupted individual, technology development, this huge upsurge of technical development in the economy, the new worlds of gadgets, lifts, trains, electric lighting, their salesmen and operators, and the ways in which people have their narratives enfolded around technology and devices, which I feels quite Rossian.
Yeah, well, in terms of his, you know, his kind of reverie on the nature of what the city is about, yeah.
these people in boxes and the enforced interactions of a person, and the fact that there are all sorts of new categories of semi-public. The semi-public, like the lift operator turned away but listening, the telephone operator,
I suppose,
tram drivers.
I suppose what seems to contradict the sort of thesis of the architecture of the city in terms of the American city is that it does seem on the surface as if there are very few monuments, or perhaps none at all, that almost any building is disposable. That, you know, if there's anything in New York which exerts that powerful of an effect on the development of the city, it's the plan, it's the grid.
Yeah, what holds much more true is his analysis of residential districts, of what he calls residential districts, which is just to say that the controlling influences on the architecture, what would be sort of urban poche, is that is a lot of things, including institutional, cultural, institutional rules, cultural norms, laws. But that in America, the poche has expanded to include absolutely everything. Because there aren't, as you say, monuments. I mean, there are monuments in American cities.
But there
aren't monuments which are human-sized.
Yeah, there's an issue of kind of urban scale, of everything being further apart. I mean, not monument. I mean, we need to be careful. You have to understand us using the word.
Listen first to our 4 hours on Aldo Rossi.
God, yeah, no, we're using the word monument in the context that Rossi means it. Not obviously, there are lots of historic and interesting buildings in America. That's not what we're saying. We're not denying the existence of them. Of those, but there's a specific meaning that he applies to that term, which actually is
there's a real habit in theory and analysis to invent terms which you then give you the ability to go, no, but actually I meant this.
Yeah. Sorry, I think we'll just head that off.
You've misunderstood me.
As again, there's a kind of a follow-on. So actually, the book which we're using for the podcast today, we owe to this resurgence of interest, and it was produced as part of a show which also incorporated this thing called late entries, which was lots of people in 1980 or whenever it was themselves having a go at the brief of the competition, and the big two-volume book with the original entries and also with the late entries was produced at the time. The late entries are pretty bad.
It's an interesting thing that they're like. I know we're not meant to like the Ayn Rand description of, like, it's a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy.
Yeah.
I know this isn't good, but that's what they are.
They're incredibly lame. Also, because they're just...
They take images. They take an image of the images in the competition without taking the generative forces of them. They abstract them from their context, and they take a particular realm of quality, and then they put that through the lens of their analysis, and they spit out various things, which, if they are interesting, and they occasionally are interesting incidentally to what is being done. There are a couple of takes which are sort of extrapolations on various of the strange themes.
Yeah. For me, the best ones are the ones which are just an expression of someone's extremely individual and extremely strong style. So there's one by Ando, by Tadao Ando, and one by Gaetano Pesce, both of which are like very, very in their way of doing things.
The Pesce one has really got nothing to do with...
No.
It's got nothing to do with anything.
It's this mad...
You could put any label on it like. It's nothing.
It's this is this kind of crazy sculptural relief with sort of faces. Is the Ando
one the one where, which is like the last one in the book, where it's got a light core and then it's got another building on top?
No, the Ando one...
Which one's that one?
That one is...
Because that one's slightly interesting.
Is it Helmut Jain? There's a Helmut Jain one, which is the actual real scheme, but with a sort of strange mirrored reflection of it hanging above it, which is hollow. Anyway, there's not all that much to say about them.
They play a lot with the idea of image, the image of the city reflected in a building, often literally, and with icon, for example, a giant clothes peg. Saying I am an icon.
You know what I find we have talked about the original entries as collage to some extent, or as assemblage, but fundamentally, because they've had to try and integrate those things together, it just makes the whole thing much stronger and much more charged with tension. The late entries, because they're working at the level of graphics almost, are just limp. This doesn't have the same charge.
Also, the late entries regarded themselves as a success, whereas the dissonance, which was seen in the entries of the competition, was not regarded as a success. It was regarded as a failure and an incomplete science.
So it's suppressed.
We don't actually want to just have a temple on top of our skyscraper, but that is the solution they got to at that point. Yeah. And the ones that are judged to be highly successful in their time are the ones which managed to synthesize.
I think the synthesis is that, yeah, where they perceived one of those tensions, they try to finesse or to add a third element or to find some means of articulation by which that tension can be suppressed.
And that's why the Serenian one is it manages to integrate. It manages to create a synthesis of the problem,
yeah,
which is why I think it was well regarded.
I'll just mention it in passing. There's a sort of follow-on essay. I think probably goes along with this same event by Diana Agrest, which is going over a lot of the same ground and kind of attempts a sort of linguistic. It has this sort of linguistic analysis, which I think is sort of borrowed from like Roman Jakobson's Six Functions of Language or something. You know, is this Gothic connotative, as in expressing what Gothic is meant to express, or is it metalinguistic, as in a use of the Gothic which is meant to make us think about the nature of architectural expression or whatever?
I can't really talk about this because it's two things that I haven't read and suspect are nonsense.
I don't want to like run down this article too much. I don't find it very convincing. But I should credit it with, I came across it by accident, and actually it's one of the big things which made me think we should definitely try and do a podcast about this competition. So I would credit it with that much.
I need
a lot of good pictures.
You must another implement to look at all of these, but also not just to look at them, but to keep looking and thinking about them, because there's a rich lot of things going on. You can get very distracted by the surface. But there's a lot to learn.
Yeah.
And then also look at the place, what is represented, what isn't represented, and the relationship with the city.
I think we're almost at an end.
So what does it mean, Luke? The competition is an artifact of its time, and it's an artifact of publicity. What do you think the people felt when they were putting the Doric temples on the top of the buildings? Because it's totally mad, but they all seem to have done it.
Yeah.
And you can't just... I don't believe you can just explain it by going, they'd heard of Beaux-Arts architecture, and so they all thought that they would turn it into a temple.
I think that that they have internalized a certain vision of civic architecture, which I think an idea of the civic, an idea of the kind of better city, is still one of the big motivations, which I think is common to, you know, the vast majority of people who do architecture, that they're in it to make urban environments better, more humane, more civilized, more delightful, to improve the lives of everyone who lives in them, and that they have deeply internalized a particular image of what that's like, and that therefore they are trying to make a reconciliation between that and what is actually going on economically in architecture, which is the production of these bigger and bigger skyscrapers, these huge extruded floor plates going up and up and up. You know, architecture is very often about trying to find that compromise trying to find the way to the best of the situation in which we find ourselves. That sort of rhetoric is something which is very common, isn't it? Here's where we've ended up. It's something which you find in Le Corbusier. This is the sort of situation that we've got to, and here's how we can use what design gives us in order to plot a way out of it, or plot a way to a better world, but through the instrument of design. And so I think that's why they look like that, is because they're imagining that we're going to sort of stop all this kind of vulgar, sort of speculative knocking everything down and building it up again. Actually, we're going to start constructing a better city now. And they're probably all going to be like this.
I'm not sure about that last bit. I think, at a really basic level, I think it's got something to do with the elites running this society are haute bourgeois capitalists who have a particular sort of Gilded Age taste and aspiration. And they are really in charge of the aspiration for the city. I don't think there's a notion that this stuff is going to stop being thrown up and knocked down. I think that's part of the great sort of strength of the culture.
Oh, but I'm not sure.
I think it's dialectic capitalism.
Yeah, but I don't think architects have ever really they're very happy with stuff being thrown up, but they're not happy with it being torn down. I mean, no one who builds a building with a Doric temple on the top is thinking, oh, well, I don't really care if this gets knocked down in 40 years. They think it's going to be there forever.
Yeah, but they always do. Yeah. But they live in synthesis with the commanders of society's resources, which in this case were haute bourgeois capitalists. Who seem to have had... if you look at the interiors of Gilded Age houses, they're mad.
I mean, we can say briefly what the building, I think, is still partly occupied by the Chicago Tribune.
Yeah, they're occupying as much, I think, as they ever did, more or less. I mean, I expect they got bigger and then have recently got smaller, like newspapers do in general.
Now rebranded as Tronk. Did you see that?
Really?
Yes, Tribune Company has been rebranded as Tronk.
As in, like, the system whereby they take your tips away from you.
Tronk. With a C. I think.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it was good. It was good. There were an awful lot of memes about its terribleness. Like, 50 Shades of Grey, my desires are unconventional, open door, Tronk.
Yeah.
I looked it up on Wikipedia. It says, an interesting fact is that the Tribune Tower contains many famous stones incorporated in the wall.
They are on the exterior wall of the building. I've seen a video of this.
Yeah.
They're literally like, this is a piece of rock from this geological formation.
Yeah.
This is a piece of rock from an Aztec, but they're just rocks. Yeah. They're not bits of carved tracery.
They've got a bit of the Colosseum.
Yeah, it's just a rock.
Yeah. And also from the Great Wall of China. I mean, it says the Chinese Wall. I assume they mean the Great Wall of China.
Well, there are several of those anyway.
Yeah.
So we're going to talk about, in the next one, some more competitions. And I think each of them also is driven by a different worldview. So this is the American Gilded Age, or sort of post-Gilded Age.
In a way, we're also covering the sort of various bases of clients. So here we have...
That's all this kind of... You know,
sort of have great robber barons at one remove here in the...
I mean, I think it's partly cleaning up the act. There was a real backlash to the way they'd...
Yeah.
I mean, quite rightly. Unlike Ayn Rand, I'm less convinced about the merits of monopoly capitalism. I think it's something that is highly repressive to economies.
And then to come, we have sort of state or multilateral sort of bureaucracy. And then we have communism.
Totalitarian dictatorship.
Yeah. But of the good sort.
If you say so.
So thanks a lot for continuing to email.
We've had some nice ones.
Yeah, I have one or two which I still have to answer on my to-do list. But very much appreciated. Please... continue to talk to us and
reviews in all the places, recommend reviews, us to everybody,
recommendations. What I find works is to take the phone of someone you know and find the podcast app and then subscribe for them, and then
then you're away
that shows up in the stats, you know.
Yeah, it's good.
Every time you go out, try and do that. Try and get a streak going. Try and do it every couple of days. Make a little mark in your calendar. It's kind of positive feedback.
Oh, should we shout out to it's not Ayn Rand is disgusting, it's you.
Oh, I think I've shouted out enough to that person. Yeah. We had our first bit of is it trolling? It's not really trolling.
No.
Complaint. Constructive criticism.
I actually had someone come up to me in the street and complain that my take on that I completely misunderstood Ayn Rand.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, people do love it.
She's got a lot of fans.
I find, like, the more I read about the architecture of this period, the more I understand it's a very sort of distorted reflection, but at least the thing that it's a reflection of becomes clearer. You know, I start to recognise who's being caricatured.
Yes, the buildings in this definitely conform to some of the more ridiculous descriptions in the Fountainhead.
Absolutely. Thanks a lot for listening, and goodbye.